experience that happened in Virginia last year, and I hope I don't step on any toes, but I've been known to. Last year, American laws for American courts really didn't even come up. It never even got the first hearing in committee. There was a competing bill, which was introduced by a delegate in the House of Delegates by the name of Marshall, which I'm sure he had very good motivation and instincts and everything, but it was a bad bill. It's a really, really bad bill. It wouldn't accomplish anything, and it was poorly conceived and written, and it failed because there was essentially no support for it, because the people on our side, once they found out that it did not accomplish what needed to be accomplished, didn't want to support it, and then the people on the other side were against it, just like they were against all of these types of bills. So that's the problem we ran into in Virginia last year. Our problem in Virginia this year is that we don't have a bill sponsor. For an A-like bill in Virginia.
Spirit of him. Thank you for being here, sir. Thanks for your testimony. We've got trouble. I mentioned this mosque in Sterling, one of the most radical, even more so than this one, is the one that until recently was run by the Al-Waqi in Fairfax. Paul Sperry has done a wonderful book called Infiltration a number of years ago. He's talked about what he calls the Wahhabi corridor that runs basically from up in London down to Richmond. And again, let me emphasize, there are lots of Muslims in this Commonwealth and elsewhere around the country that are not the problem. But there are lots of people in that Wahhabi corridor. And I must tell you, somebody who frequently travels in and out of Dulles Airport, I'm thinking I'm seeing a lot of them in all kinds of positions in that airport and elsewhere in the service sector and so on, that are translating increasingly into constituents. And it's not just Tom King. You know, I have to tell you, it's George Allen. It's even as good a guy as I think we've got, Frank, who are now being encouraged or seduced or induced to recognize these folks as people who are contributors, who are people who will host events for them, people who will, you know, otherwise help them do their jobs. And a case in point, I must tell you, is a man who is now representing the House, the part of Virginia here where I live, in the House of Delegates, Imam David Ramadan. And I don't know if this is a name that you know yet, but I imagine you're going to hear more about him. He too, along with Simon Marquis, was just announced to be one of the national co-chairs of the Romney Arab American. Bill Murray was with me when we had an event in Leesburg shortly before he was elected by 50 votes, in which, among other things, it was pointed out that nobody has explained where the immense money he somehow came up with while he was living out of the country has come from, but we know where a lot of it is gone. It's gone into Republican Party organizations and political officials. And many of them were trotted out to endorse him. Some of them are now hanging with him in the course of this campaign. And this is a problem, because it goes to this lady's question. How do you know whether this guy is a problem, this guy is one of those Muslims that we want on the team? Well, one of the best investigative reporters I know, a colleague of ours by the name of Ken Timmerman, who happens to be running for the House of Representatives in Maryland as we speak. You're probably with the next money. I encourage you to give it to Ken. He's in a very, very interesting race against one of the up-and-coming stars of the Democratic Party in the House. But Ken spent a lot of time in the Middle East as a reporter, including in Beirut. And he says, you know, I have a lot of Muslim friends, a lot of Muslim sources, dealt with a lot of people in the very crucible from which their Ramadan Imad, or their Ramadan, hails. And he said, I was struck by the fact that one of the little known facts about Ramadan was that in his first marriage, and it's not entirely clear that it ever ended, but his father-in-law was a major general in Lebanese intelligence with close ties to Hezbollah and the Assad regime in Syria. And as Ken said, you know, it's kind of like the mafia. You don't marry into the family of a major general in Lebanese intelligence unless you're with the program. Now, maybe he's not anymore. Or maybe he is. But that's the kind of question that the people of the 7th District, I think, were not adequately exposed to. And had they been, I don't think that they would have voted in that. But my point is this. He's in now. And he's burrowing. And this is a problem for Republicans as well as Democrats. It's a problem for all of us. If in fact, as I fear, his alignment is closer to the Islamists than to the peaceable, tolerant, law-abiding Muslims. Yes, sir.
There's something on the order of, in the conversation about, you know, kind of one side versus the other, sometimes gets kind of left out, just the sheer massive scale of the number of people you're talking about worldwide. I mean, there's 1.5 billion or something just shy of that Muslims in the world. And, you know, everything I've seen in the last 6 or 8 years trying to understand it better is sort of led me to believe that 10 to 20% are kind of in the category of fundamental Sharia, fundamental, you know, folks. Maybe there's 10 or 20%, I doubt that sometimes watching the worldwide news, but maybe there's the same number that are in the category of secular, if you would, that, you know, would be people you could live next to and they wouldn't want to shoot you and your baby. It seems like the group in between drifts by intimidation or nature towards the more fundamental. So you're talking about in the best of scenarios, 200 to 400 million people, you know, greater than the sum total of America, you know, worldwide, they're in the category that there's only three options for anybody non-Islam. You kill them, you send them somewhere else and you can kill them later, or you, Demetritude, you tax them to death. You know, much like the Obamacare is highly focused, and there's an out in large extent for usury for anybody of Islamic faith. So, is that like consistent with what you see, or are those numbers way out there? Or do you have any kind of sense of the scale, you know, worldwide? I guess that's the question.
Yeah, look, this is a very important question, and I don't know that anybody really has a good answer to it. I've heard estimates of 10% that are really with this jihadist program.
Yeah.
That's a staggeringly large number of people.
Yeah, and the idea that it's just some small number of extremists is just nonsense. That's brilliant.
Let's put a fine point on what we're being told right now by an administration that is working closely with the Muslim Brotherhood, is that what we're up against is just Al-Qaeda. And I don't know if you've heard this, but they've repeatedly said that there are 50 Al-Qaeda operatives left in Afghanistan. which feeds into the argument that you're decimating them, they're on the path to defeat, and it's, you know, this is really pretty much all wrapped up. Even if it were just Al-Qaeda we're up against, there are plenty more than 50. And they're not just in Afghanistan. Increasingly, they're actually taking over countries. And to places where they're not taking over countries, but the Muslim Brotherhood is, like Egypt, they are now in business with safeguards, to say nothing of Mali and northern Nigeria and Yemen. The good news, if there is any good news, is that I think the number of Sharia adherent Muslims in this country is relatively small. But the bad news is that to the extent that we keep legitimating and empowering and enriching and emboldening the Islamist sort of leading edge, the Muslim Brotherhood, as the community leaders, we are essentially communicating to everybody else in the community, they better get with the program. They better do what these community leaders insist, which is submit to them and their program. So it's a matter of time, I'm afraid, before this translates into what we see elsewhere around the world, which is growing numbers that are radicalized. Instead of being part of, part of what we hope is the antidote to this threat. Scott, can we just take one last question?